subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga.
Hello, viewers. Welcome to Newspeak South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Pakistan-based terror outfits using drones to smuggle arms and drugs into India. Two Afghan female judges shot dead in Kabul as wave of targeted killings continues. And US redesignates Pak-based Lashkar-e-Taiba and Lashkar-e-Jangvi as terror groups. Strict security measures after the abrogation of Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir has left terrorists short of arms and ammunition. Now, Pakistan is making all efforts to develop ingenious ways to ensure supply of weapons to terrorists. The use of drones to airdrop weapons across line of control has been unearthed by the Indian security agencies. A report.
Jammu and Kashmir police busted a terror module in Ramban district by arresting two terror operatives along with a huge quantity of arms and ammunition. The recoveries, including rifles, grenades, magazines, bullets and pistols, were reportedly airdropped by Jaish-e-Mohammed operatives from across the border in Samba district. The usage of drones by Pakistan-based terrorists for supplying arms to terrorists in Kashmir is alarming.
With miniature drones easily available, and their use not very difficult, it's quite likely that drones may become the weapon of choice as far as the Pak-sponsored terrorist groups are concerned. Pakistan can use the money earned from narcotics to buy these drones and hand over to the terrorists and also train them using them.
There has been a spurt in the use of drones by terrorists over the past few months. They use it to smuggle arms and drugs. The trend has been set up with the help of Pakistan's spy agencies and army to reduce the risk of smugglers getting eliminated at the line of control.
They can be used to carry explosives and spread explosive devices among a crowd or during religious functions, thus creating a situation of communal rights. The drones combined with artificial intelligence can prove very deadly.
The specially designed drones can carry large quantities of firearms and drugs. Experts believe that terrorists are even using these drones while infiltrating into Jammu and Kashmir and keep a track on the movement of Indian security forces. However, security forces in India are alert and technically sound to successfully foil contemporary threats.
Pakistan's desire to send weapons and drugs by drones and tunnels is definitely a challenge. Pakistan's basic desire is to destabilize Kashmir, and that remains his main intent. In fact, I must tell you that as we became strong on the LC and we were able to plug the gaps, Pakistan began to adopt alternate means of using drones to drop weapons. To defeat the use of drones, we are using some advanced technology. We have surveillance devices to detect it and thereafter jam these aerial platforms.
Pakistan is trying to make all efforts to help infiltrate terrorists into Jammu and Kashmir and create turmoil in the peace-loving and fast-developing Union Territory. There are even frequent violations of ceasefire at the line of control by the Pakistan Army to help terrorists infiltrate into India. The vigilant Indian security forces are aware of the modus operandi of Pakistan-backed terrorists who are trying every possible effort to disrupt peace in Jammu and Kashmir.
Moving on to Afghanistan. The intra-Afghan negotiations, which began last year in September, have so far not made any significant progress. Meanwhile, violence in the country has surged to new heights. While at one side, Afghan security forces are being targeted on a daily basis, journalists, human rights activists and members of civil society too have come under the radar of terrorists. Recently, two female judges working for the Supreme Court were shot dead in the capital, Kabul. A report.
This is the aftermath of a fatal attack on two female judges of Supreme Court in the capital city of Kabul. The slain judges were on their way to work in the morning when unknown gunmen ambushed and fired on their official vehicle. No one claimed responsibility for the attack. Taliban clearly denied its involvement, though they have targeted journalists and media workers in the past. This is the latest in a string of mostly unclaimed assassinations targeting officials, politicians, doctors, journalists and civil society activists in the war-torn nation. However, Afghan government blames the Taliban for the bloodshed. Many of those killed in recent weeks were actively campaigning against rampant violence and rising human rights violations. According to the data by the New York Times, at least 136 civilians and 168 security officials were killed in targeted attacks in 2020. Afghan women's rights activist Freshta Kohistani was assassinated along with her brother by unknown gunmen in Kapisa province. Her assassination came a day after unknown gunmen killed Yusuf Rashid, CEO of Free and Fair Election Forum of Afghanistan in Kabul, along with his driver. Earlier, journalist Rahmatullah Nigzad was shot dead by unknown assailants in Afghanistan's central Ghazni province. Since November 2020, a series of targeted armed attacks and bombings claimed the life of former Tolu News presenter Yama Shiawash, Radio Azadi reporter Elias Dai, Anycast TV anchor Malalai Mewand, and Aryana News presenter Fardin Amini. These murders represent a shift from targeted attacks on high-profile officials by the terrorist to civil rights activists, media persons and opinion makers in Afghanistan, threatening the voices of dissent and freedom.
This tactic by the Taliban, or the strategy adopted by the Taliban, where it's targeting journalists, government officials and so on and so forth, I think has a multifold aim. First is to target all those who are creating a public opinion within Afghanistan and outside Afghanistan against the Taliban. So when you start targeting journalists, you create a climate of fear whereby nobody starts saying anything critical about the Taliban. The other part, targeting government servants, is basically to paralyze the government. So once the government is paralyzed, it's unable to function. Chaos ensues, and it is in this chaos that the Taliban hopes to make a comeback, just as it did in 1996.
The killings are a worrying sign of how much remains unsettled as the United States is withdrawing troops from Afghanistan after nearly two decades of fighting, and have added to fears that more violence and chaos will follow. Many observers believe that Taliban is using these assassinations as a complement to their coordinated assaults on Afghan security forces to terrorize Afghan society into submitting to whatever terms emerge from the talks, whether that is a peace agreement or civil war. The Pentagon announced it had cut troop levels in Afghanistan to 2,500. It is the lowest number of American troops since the start of the war two decades ago. Last February, Trump administration struck a deal with the Taliban to reduce American troop levels in phases and to go to zero by May 2021. However, it is unclear how the new administration led by President Joe Biden will proceed with the peace talks.
Let's now talk about Pakistan-based terror groups and emerging global security threat from their existence. Ahead of the Financial Action Task Force meeting, the U.S. administration has retained the foreign terrorist organization designations for the Lashkar-e-Taiba and Lashkar-e-Jhangvi. The U.S. State Department's decision to continue treating these outfits as terror organizations suggests that it is as potent as ever, despite cosmetic steps taken by Islamabad.
Amid extreme pressure from international organizations, Pakistan continues to hide dreaded terrorists and provide them finance, shelter, and training. Why not? These terrorists are assets for Pakistani security agencies who have been using them as proxies against India, Afghanistan, and against its own people. Reviewing the threats emerging from global terror outfits, the United States has decided to retain designation of Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Taiba and Lashkar-e-Jhangvi, along with several other terror organizations, as foreign terrorist organizations. The move has come just weeks before the Financial Action Task Force's meeting in February, wherein the status of Islamabad in the grey list would be discussed. Based upon a review of the administrative records of these organizations, it was found that their modus operandi has not been changed in order to warrant revocation of the designations. Lashkar-e-Taiba was designated as a terrorist organization by the United States in December 2001 after the deadly terror attack on Indian Parliament. Since the original designation occurred, these terror outfit has repeatedly changed its name and created front organizations in an effort to avoid sanctions.
The initial statements which are coming from the frontline nominees of the Biden administration, which has taken over the presidency in the United States just yesterday, are very encouraging, particularly with reference to countering terrorism. General Lloyd Austin, who is the defense secretary nominee, in his deliberations and propositions with the Armed Service Committee of the Senate, has really clearly indicated that strong action is required to counter proxies such as the Lashkar-e-Taiba, which are being emanating from Pakistan.
Pakistan hosts the most dangerous terrorist outfits in the world. Today, the United States realizes that Pakistan-based terrorists pose a threat not just to South Asia, but the Western world too. Washington cannot forget that for several years, Pakistan provided shelter to Osama bin Laden, the mastermind of 9/11 attacks. There are a significant number of groups based in Afghanistan which operate with the support of Pakistan, and therefore, the United States has also routinely criticized Islamabad for supporting the Afghan Taliban and Haqqani network, both of which frequently attack US troops and coalition forces.
There are very firm indications that the United States will collaborate and cooperate with India in countering terrorism emanating from Pakistan. In his testimony to the US United States Senate, General Lloyd Austin, who is nominated as a defense secretary, has very clearly indicated that there is a requirement to do much more by Pakistan for countering terrorism and not allow its territory to be given to terrorist groups to operate from there. With these statements, one is confident that the Biden administration will be taking a very strong action against threat to global terror, which will also naturally facilitate India's counter response to terror emanating from Pakistan.
Pakistan has a long history of terror sponsorship. The military establishment has played a central role in Pakistan's use of terrorist groups as proxies. But contrary to long-standing presumptions in Washington, Pakistan's civilian establishment by no means serves as a check against these policies. Terror sponsorship has become a kind of whole-of-government principle of Pakistan's security policy, and therefore punitive US actions to discourage it have little chance of success. Hence, the new government in the United States needs to adopt a more informed and constructive approach towards Pakistan with an aim to act against terror sanctuaries based out there.
With the beginning of the new year, India began a new journey at the United Nations Security Council as it became its non-permanent member for the eighth time. Ever since, New Delhi, which is not only at the forefront of fighting terrorism, especially cross-border terrorism, but is also one of its biggest victims, has been raising the issue of international terrorism and its sponsor at the council. A report.
India has been a constant victim of Pakistan-backed terrorism. However, with its revived counter-terrorism strategies, the country has not only managed to defeat this menace at home, but is also leading the collective fight against this global threat, along with the world's powerful economies like the United States. Going on the same routes, India assumed the temporary membership of the United Nations Security Council at the beginning of 2021. And ever since, it has been raising its voice against the acts of terrorism at the global level. Hoping that conflict in Syria will end completely, India recently said that it is ready to play a constructive and meaningful role in the United Nations Security Council towards achieving that objective.
The presence of foreign terrorist fighters, along with continued terror activities, has worsened the situation on the ground. It is imperative that all parties must adhere to their international obligations to fight terrorism and terrorist organizations in Syria as designated by the Security Council.
According to the Global Terrorism Index 2020, Greater Middle East continues to be the focal point of terrorism, while South Asia suffered most fatalities. Yemen, one of the Arab world's poorest countries, is witnessing the world's worst humanitarian crisis. The Yemeni civil war has evolved from a struggle for power into a violent conflict defined by tribal and ethnic lines. Terrorists from Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula and the local affiliate of the rival Islamic State terror group have taken advantage of the chaos by seizing several areas and carrying out deadly attacks, notably in Erbil. A few days back, at least 22 people were killed and more than 50 wounded in an attack at the airport in southern Yemeni city of Aden. Being the head of the Counter-Terrorism Committee at UNSC, India condemned this attack and called for the perpetrators of this heinous act to be held accountable and urged the international community to support the Yemeni government in its efforts to do so, ensuring that terrorists do not take advantage of such situation.
The targeting of the civilian airport and the killing of government officials, civilians and others is unacceptable and cannot be justified for any reason whatsoever. The perpetrators of this heinous act should be held accountable, and I urge the international community to support the government of Yemen in its efforts to do so. We should ensure that terrorists do not take advantage of such situation.
Jihadist and Islamic terrorist organizations are also gaining momentum in West African countries. Groups like Islamic State, Boko Haram and Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb continue to expand through affiliates all over Africa, including Nigeria and Mali. Despite the presence of French and UN peacekeeping forces in Mali, armed groups are still very active and carry out violent attacks, killing thousands of soldiers and civilians.
The main reason for the coup d'etat and the overthrow of the civilian government in 2012 was the alleged mishandling of the situation in northern Mali. The situation further worsened due to the offensive and terrorist and extremist armed groups in southern Mali in early 2013. MINUSMA took over from AFISMA only in July 2013.
In today's globalized world, no country is immune to the threat of terrorism. The devastation due to COVID-19 pandemic has further underscored the importance of global cooperation. In the words of India's External Affairs Minister, the country's approach will be guided by 5S: Samman, Samvad, Sahyog, Shanti and Samriddhi, meaning respect, dialogue, cooperation, peace and prosperity. With such approach, India would be able to launch a collective mechanism against the massive threat posed by terrorism for preserving international peace and security.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nrin.com. This is Shreya Savijay, signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.